Good afternoon. We'll talk today about how to develop an equation or a system actually of equations like this one, where we have the mass matrix that corresponds to all the degrees of freedom of the system, not just one element, but the assembly of the elements, times the vector of the accelerations of the nodes, plus the stiffness matrix, again, of the whole system, plus times the vector of the displacements, and this will be equal to the vector of the forces that are applied to, again, the nodes that correspond to the system. And here is the problem that we face when once we develop the stiffness and the mass matrices of the elements. This is where actually we stopped the last time. We explained how to develop the mass and stiffness matrices of an element. And the problem is, once you have done that, the coordinate systems that you use are not compatible. For example, if you have this bridge, you have this inclined element, this inclined beam, and the coordinate system that we have used for the beam is this coordinate system. This is the x direction, this is the, say the y direction. Now, this is for this beam. If you consider this beam, we have a different coordinate system, another beam, a different coordinate system. So these are incompatible. We need to make a transformation so that everything is with respect to a single coordinate system. So this will be one of the steps that we have to complete in order to come up with this type of equations. So let's see the steps that it takes in order to come up with this system of equations that we can solve to find the response of the system. So we have the mass stiffness matrix for an element or all the elements with respect to the coordinate system that is specific for each element. So we have here displacements with respect to the coordinate system of a particular element, forces, stiffness, and mass matrices. Now, these are different, so we need to develop equations or transform these mass and stiffness matrices from the element coordinate system to a global coordinate system. So you will have new vectors with respect to a common coordinate system that we call global coordinate system, and this will be the new displacement vector, force vector, stiffness, and mass matrices for all the elements. But this will be with respect to the same coordinate system. Once you achieve that step, the next step is to assemble the equations for all the elements to come up with a system of equations that you can solve. And there's another step which I omitted, which is, but we'll cover in this class, which is to impose the boundary conditions. For example, if you have a bridge, you have some supports, and these typically do not move, so the displacements are zero, so you have to account for that, and that requires a transformation that we're going to talk about today. So let's go to the second step, which is transformation of the stiffness and mass matrices, so that everything is with respect to the same coordinate system. So transformation of stiffness and mass matrices. Okay. We'll consider and demonstrate the method on the beam. So we start with the local coordinate system. Let's say that this is the beam. We have displacement U1 and the force E1. We have on the right end U2, and then the inclination angle is theta. This is the element coordinate system, and we abbreviate it as EC. And what we want is to transform the equations so they are written with respect to a global coordinate system. So the same element again, but a different coordinate system. This is the global coordinate system. We have the horizontal component, U1 hat, U2 hat, P2 hat denotes global coordinate system. U3 hat, P3 hat, and U4 hat, P4 hat. Okay, so we'll derive the equations from the equations that are written with respect to the element coordinate system to the equations with respect to the global coordinate system. So let's mention a lemma which we are going to use for the transformation. So lemma, this is a kind of a mini theorem, simple theorem. If U is the vector with respect to the element coordinate system, and then U hat is the vector with respect to the global coordinate system, then there is a relation between these two vectors. Okay? Notice that the two vectors don't have the same number of elements. This has two elements, this has four. But still there is a transformation, and this is the transformation. You get U with respect to the element coordinate system if you multiply this vector with respect to the global coordinate system times a transformation matrix. So this is a transformation matrix times U hat. Okay? What are the dimensions of the transformation matrix? Well, this is 2 times 1. This is 4 times 1. A column vector with 4 elements. So this got to be 2 times 4. Okay, so this is a matrix with 2 rows and 4 columns. Okay, now what is this transformation matrix thing? T, which is 2 by 4, has columns. The projections of unit vectors on the global coordinate system onto unit vectors of the element coordinate system. So it has columns, the projections, of unit vectors of global coordinate system onto the unit vectors of their local. Coordinate system, so element coordinate system. Okay, so what you do is to take the vectors of the global coordinate system, these 4 vectors, you find their projections on the local coordinate system, and then this actually becomes the columns of this transformation matrix. Okay? So the transformation matrix in this particular example is a 2 by 4 matrix, and the elements are cosine theta, the cosine of this angle, which is the same as this one, okay? Cosine theta, then we have 0, sine theta, 0, okay? Then 0 cosine theta and 0 sine theta. Okay? For example, if you take this element, the projection on in this direction is just cosine theta. And that's why you have cosine theta. Okay? And there's no this element here, there's no component in this direction, okay? On this end, that's why you have a 0 here. Okay. And we'll abbreviate it just for convenience. The cosine will abbreviate it as C, and the sine by S. So we have CS, 0, C, 0, and S. Okay. So this is used in this relation where we have the displacements with respect to the global answers with respect to the local times the transformation matrix times u hat. Okay, now if you want to express u hat, which are the displacements with respect to the global coordinate system in terms of u, the displacements with respect to the local coordinate system, then you use this equation where we have u hat, okay, u hat is equal to the transpose of the transformation matrix times u. Okay? And that means that u hat is the product of this matrix, which is 4 by 2, so we have cosine, it's the transpose of this matrix, so we have cosine 0, S, 0, 0, C, 0, S. And this is the displacement in the local coordinate system, okay? So this again is a 2 by 1. This is 4 by 1. All right. As an example, let's say that you have three elements connected together, three beams connected together. There are three nodes, node number 1, 2, and 3. And in terms of the lengths, this is 50 inches. This inclined element is 50 inches. This dimension is 40 inches. Okay. And the coordinate system is X and Y. This is the coordinate system. Okay, so let's see what is the transformation matrix for the first element. Here you have three elements, three nodes, three elements, so you need three transformation matrices in order to be able to write the equations with respect to the global coordinate system, which is x and y, and we'll just write the one for this element. So the transformation matrix for this element. well, the transformation matrix for the first element is 1/5 4 0 3 0 0 4 4 3. Okay, we just used this piece of information in order to derive the transformation matrix for element 1. Okay, so this is the transformation matrix of element 1. And you have similarly transformation matrices for these three elements, but I'm not going to write them because it is obvious how to do that. Okay, let's consider also a beam element. Okay, we're going to consider a beam element on the plane, so we'll have 6 degrees of freedom. Three for one end and three for the other end of the beam. So if this is the beam, you have a horizontal displacement, a vertical displacement, and also rotation. So three for one end and three for the upper right end, a total of 6. Okay. So transformation matrix P of beam element in plane. Here is the beam element in plane. This angle is theta with respect to the horizontal. We have U1, U2. Okay, now this is a beam. So it has resistance both in the axial direction and in the vertical direction on the beam. You have also rotation, U3. And then similarly, you have axial displacement along the beam, vertical displacement, U5, and rotation, U6. Okay? And what we want is to write the equations with respect to the global coordinate system, where we have horizontal, vertical, and rotation. So same element, but different coordinate system. Here is the element again. And now the coordinates are horizontal. So we have a component of the displacement in the horizontal direction, U1 hat. We have another component, U2 hat. We have rotation, U3 hat, okay, and this angle by the way is theta. And then we have the counterparts of these displacements for the right end. So we have U4 hat, U5 hat, and U6. the rotation. All right. Then the relation of the displacements with respect to the local and the global coordinate systems is this. Is u equal to the transformation matrix T times u hat. So when you multiply the vector of the displacements with respect to the global coordinate system, you pre-multiply it by the transformation matrix to get the displacements in the local coordinate system. Okay? And T, as we said, T is a matrix, and in this case it's a 6x6 matrix because we have 6x1 here and 6x1, two column vectors with six elements. So this is 6x6. Okay. And what are the elements of this matrix? Well, they are the projections of the global onto the local coordinates. Okay? So we have a 6x6 matrix. So let's start with the first column. Cosine theta minus sine theta, and then four zeros. Okay, well, let's make it a little bit bigger. That's the first element, that's the first column. Second column is S, C, and then zeros everywhere else. Then we have zero, one. This one corresponds to rotation. And this is equal to one because rotation doesn't change. Okay? It's common for both coordinate systems. Then we have zeros elsewhere. Okay? And then the fourth column is zero, C, cosine, minus sine, zero, okay? Zero, S, C, zero. And the last column has just one at the bottom, so you have the last element, which is equal to one. Okay, so this is the transformation matrix. So if you multiply the global, the vector of the displacements in the global coordinate system with this matrix, then you get the displacements in the local coordinate system. That means the coordinate system for which the displacements are written with respect to the directions of the beam, not the horizontal and the vertical directions. Okay? Now, we have this transformation, but what we really want is the stiffness matrix in the coordinate, in the global coordinate system. So, what do we do to find the stiffness matrix of a beam with respect to global coordinate system if we have the stiffness matrix with respect to the local coordinate system? So, transformation of the stiffness matrix. The concept is that if you write the expression for the strain energy with respect to the local or the global coordinate system, the strain energy is the same. So we'll use that fact in order to find the transformation for the stiffness matrix. Okay? So the strain energy, if you write it with respect to the local coordinate system, it is just the vector of the displacement in the local coordinates, transpose, times the stiffness matrix, times the displacement vector. But this is the same as the strain energy with respect to the global coordinate system. So this is equal to 1/2 the transpose of the vector of the displacements with respect to the global coordinate system times the stiffness matrix in the global coordinate system times u hat. And these two are equal, okay? Now, we remember also that the displacements with respect to the local and the global coordinate system are related through this equation. The displacements with respect to the local coordinate system are the transformation matrix times the displacement with respect to the global coordinate system. Okay? So we're going to plug this expression into this equation. Okay? And hopefully this will give us a relation between the two stiffness matrices in the local and the global coordinate system. Okay, so let's do that. Using these two facts, we have that 1/2 u hat t times transformation matrix transpose times k times transformation matrix times the displacement in the global coordinate system, that got to be equal to the strain energy when we write it with respect to the local coordinate system, which is this, okay? So let's say that this is equal to 1/2 hat transpose times the K matrix times U hat. Okay. All right. Now let's look at these relations in order to have the left hand side equal to the right hand side, or the upper part of the equation equal to the lower part. What conditions should be satisfied? Well, this product of the transpose of the transformation matrix times the stiffness in the element coordinates times the transformation matrix should be equal to k hat. Okay? So that's the relation of the stiffness matrix in the global coordinate system with the stiffness matrix in the local. So that's a relation. So If you have k in the local coordinate system, that means the directions parallel to the beam, then you pre-multiply with the transpose of the transformation matrix, and you post-multiply with the transformation matrix, and this new matrix is the stiffness matrix with respect to the global coordinate system. That means the coordinate system with the horizontal direction, vertical direction, and rotation, okay? Now, it is easy to extrapolate this equation for the mass matrix, to find the mass matrix with respect to the global coordinate system. So here it is. Similarly, the mass matrix with respect to the global coordinate system is the transpose of the transformation matrix times the mass matrix in the local coordinates times the transformation matrix, okay? Same relation, except that instead of k, now we have n. All right. So this is how we get the mass matrix. Now, one more thing that we need is the force vector. The force vector, if you express it with respect to local coordinate systems, you need to do a transformation so that it is written with respect to the global coordinate system. So for the force vector, if you have forces written, expressed in terms of a system that is parallel to the beam, we have this relation. This is the vector of the forces in the local coordinate system, which is equal to the transformation matrix times forces in the global coordinates. Okay? This is the relation. All right, so if you want to get an expression for p hat, what you have to do is to say that p hat, the forces with respect to the global coordinate system, is the transpose of this transformation matrix, so it is t transpose times the forces in the local coordinate system. Okay, so this is how you express the forces with respect to the global coordinate system. Okay, so let's summarize what we learned. Conclusion. One. To find the stiffness matrix of an element in the global coordinate system, then you pre-multiply by the transpose of the transformation matrix, the stiffness matrix in the local system, and you post-multiply by the transformation matrix. So, to find, I will just write what I said, to find the stiffness matrix of an element in the global coordinate system. You must remultiply by the transpose of the transformation matrix and post multiply by the transformation matrix. Okay, now for the mass matrix, that's it. An analogous statement that I will not bother to write. All you have to do is just replace stiffness with mass. Okay? And then you are in business. Okay? So, you can actually, yeah. You see, this is the extension of the mass matrix. And then for the force, what you have to do is to multiply the force vector by the transpose of the transformation matrix. So to find the force vector, in the global coordinate system, remultiply by the transpose of the transformation matrix. Okay, so let's see what we have done so far. We have derived the mass difference matrices for an element, and we have also found a way to transform these matrices from the element coordinates into global coordinates. Okay? And that allows you to assemble all these matrices into a single mass and a single stiffness matrices. Okay, so now we have to assemble these matrices. That's the next step. Assembly of mass and stiffness matrices. So if we go back to the example that we showed earlier with the bridge. these are the elements of the bridge. Okay, let's put it in our base to make it more interesting. Okay, now we have the mass and the stiffness matrices and the forces with respect to a single coordinate system, the vertical and the horizontal direction, and of course, rotation. Okay? Now, what is missing here? Well, we have the stiffness matrices, but they are the individual stiffness matrices of individual elements. Now, we need to find the stiffness matrix of the whole system. We need to assemble now the individual stiffness matrices into the whole stiffness matrix and mass matrix of the entire system. So let's just review what our objective is. We started with equations of motion for the elements. Equations of motion for elements. And these were with respect to the element coordinates. Okay? The element coordinates. Okay, so we have, let's symbolize them with UE, E, displacement, forces, and then we have stiffness with respect to the element coordinates and mass with respect to the element coordinates. Now, we just learned how to transform them with respect to global coordinate system. So this is a transformation, okay? And we can derive the equations of motion with respect to the global coordinate system. So equations of motion of elements, this is the same as before, but the reference is different. Now we have the global coordinates, okay? And these are symbolized with hats. Same things, same symbols, but with hats. So we have UE, hat, E, hat, K, E, hat, and M, E, hat. Okay? We have done this step. We just did that. Now, we need to assemble everything into a single coordinate system. So we have, I'm sorry, a single system. So we do assembly. And we get the equations of motion again. Of the system. So we have now a vector of displacements. The displacements of each of these degrees of freedom. Okay? So we have displacements, forces on any nodes that are subjected to force, K, the stiffness matrix in the global coordinate system, and the mass matrix. So we want to now work with this step. This is our objective now, to assemble the equations of the elements into equations for the whole system. And the way that will work, the concept is we're going to think energy-wise. We're going to equate the energy, the total energy, because of the displacements of the elements, with the total energy of the system. This would be the approach. Okay, let's stop here and then we'll continue in the next lecture.